Good evening, dear sisters and brothers. I think two things have made it difficult for me. I was going to say, one is the drama that was just played, which reflects the real life drama as a matter of fact. And that is exactly what I was going to say, with the expression drama. And there were two persons, while I am one, or there were two in one. And the other is the introduction. I don't know whether I would be able to live up to the compliments that have been paid. But both these things have also given to me the context which paves for me the road on which my thoughts should roll on. One is the drama, as I referred to earlier, the real life drama. Why there is so much noise in our head, so that we have headache. All the 24 hours of the day, all the 7 days of the week, all the 12 months of the year. Why is it that there is so much of noise? Why are we so much disturbed? The example is given of a monkey who jumps from one branch of the tree to the other branch and never sits still. He is all the time jumping because it's a monkey, and monkey is supposed to be a monkey. So that is what it is doing. But take the case of a monkey which is drunk. What will it do? And not only is it drunk, but it has been bitten by a scorpion. Not a snake. One which is bitten by a snake would feel sleepy. But one which is bitten by a scorpion would jump and jump and jump, would cry and cry and cry. So there is a monkey in every head. Darwin said that we descended from monkeys and apes. But I think that the monkey is in us still. It's not that we descended from monkey, but there is a monkey always jumping in our mind. How to calm it down? How to bring it to a state of stillness? That was the problem. And again, the case of Mahabharata, the beautiful epic poem, which was just referred to, the battleground. The battle, they say, was fought in a ground known as Kurukshetra. And I find that the whole world at present is Kurukshetra. So much is the disharmony, so much are the dissensions, so much is the conflict. There is war going on everywhere. Every human being would feel that his or her mind has become a battlefield where there is always a wrestling match going on, some kind of boxing going on, some saber rattling going on, some gun fighting going on between the forces of the evil and the virtue. A fight always going on, and this is what gives the noise. This is what makes the real sleep difficult. This is what deprives us of the real peace of mind. This Mahabharata. It's not the Mahabharata outside, but that which is inside is finding expression outside. That which is in mind finds its exteriorization in the material world. So mind is the real Kurukshetra, where the battle is raging so high, and that is why there is the noise. Then what is to be done? They say, take the case of a bee, it buzzes around, goes from one flower to the other, takes the essence. And in the Indian context, they say the bee always says it buzzes. In Hindi, I don't know what sound the bee makes in England, but in Hindi, it says bhinna, 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 bhinna. That is what the buzzing sound is, bhinna, bhinna. And bhinna, bhinna is not only the voice, the noise of the bee, but it means different, 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 different. translated into English. Perhaps, I don't know whether the bee in England translates it into English or speaks Hindi here also. But bhinna, 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 bhinna. It's not satisfied. It wants one thing after another, yet another thing, yet another thing. Never satisfied. And therefore it makes the sound bhinna, 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 bhinna. That is why it flits from one flower to the other. But when they say it sits on the beehive, then it's totally silent. So, the Indian wise men, the sages, the seers, the ancient folklore, and the ancient scriptures, the ancient spiritual heritage, gives us the message, which I would like to sum up in the very beginning of the talk, that this bhinna bhinna, this sound, would stop only when the bee, that is the mind, sits on the beehive and is totally absorbed in something very sweet, something very tasty. That is the silence. But how should it happen? That was the question. How? You should not put a question. But how? That there should be no noise. But how? You must throw out the rubbish from the dustbin of your mind. But how? That was the question. And this is what I want to discuss in the talk this evening. How to throw out that rubbish? What is the rubbish that creates the disharmony? What is it that is making sound over there instead of silence? What after all is the root of our troubles? Why there is so much of fight, so much of disharmony everywhere in all the fields of life? In fact, whatever is supposed to be creating some kind of a comfort or some kind of a remedy even to the people, even that you would find is the sign of disharmony. Take for example the health services, the hospitals, the medical colleges, the pharmacies, the shops of the chemists, the dispensaries, the doctors, the surgeons. All these are signs of civilization. They give us our good health, our better health. They look after us. And if there is a disease, they try to give us some remedies. Now this is what our civilization has given us. After a lot of scientific research over a long period of time, this is what we have attained. But the ill health itself is a sign of disharmony. Why there is ill health? Why we get diseases? Why we suffer from physical ailments? The reason 99% is that there is disharmony between the mind and the body, between the psyche and the soma. There is a fight going on between our conscience and our mind. Our mind and intellect are at loggerheads with each other. Always there is a boxing going on there, one trying to shoot the other, to oust the others. So even our arrangements for health, all what we have been able to find in the realm of health, is because there is disharmony in the mind. Similarly, all our courts, our judges, our legislatures, our law books, our law colleges, which are a sign that the society now believes in human rights and gives us an arrangement for justice, is in itself a sign that there is a lot of disharmony. Else why should there be litigation? Why should we be requiring so many laws? It is because by nature we are not law-abiding. Somewhere over there, someone is infringing laws, violating laws, breaking laws, committing crimes, social, political, economic, or whatever. It is for that reason that the arrangement has been made, that there may be justice, or what you can say, in other words, that there may be punishment to those who commit the crimes, who break the laws. So you will find that all the signs of civilizations themselves, which are considered to be a source of redressal, which are supposed to provide remedies to us, some kind of a cure for our problems, solution for our problems. Even if you interpret it in a proper way, these are indicative of the fact that there is a lot of disharmony in this world. So how it is that we should build a harmonious personality? Because unless and until every human being is a harmonious personality, there are many kinds of personalities. But you would find that there are mainly two causes for the disharmony. Anywhere, in whatever situation you find there is conflict, there is disharmony, you will find that there are two underlying causes for it. One is the passions, the other is the possessions. Someone is trying to have more and more possessions at the cost of the other. You may call it injustice, you may call it exploitation, you may call it depriving others of their due, of their human rights. So someone who wants to possess, possess and possess, and to dispossess others of their dues, of their rights, encroaches upon the rights of others. That leads to conflict in the society, that leads to confrontation. It is that which leads to disharmony. Everywhere you find this is one of the causes. The other is the passions. The passions. Because of these passions, there is emotional disturbance. And this emotional disturbance, this lack of emotional maturity, lack of control over our emotions, lack of sublimation of our emotions, leads us to conflict. Heads on, we fight. Whatever may be the words of wisdom that have been passed on to us in our national spiritual heritage, yet when the passions have been raised, whether they may be in the form of sex lust or they may be in the form of some kind of emotional involvement or attachment, you will find there is always the cause for turmoil, for trouble, for disharmony. That is what leads to disharmony. In the Gita it has been said, as it was being referred to, that there are two causes for conflict, because Gita is considered to be the essence of what the Mahabharata has to say. And this scripture says that in the beginning you like something. You say, I like this. I like this. I like this man. I like the taste of this thing. I like this melody of that thing. And so on. In the beginning there is the liking. And then from liking develops the fondness. Then you begin to say, I like it very much. I am fond of it. And then from fondness you develop attachment and intimacy. And that attachment and intimacy takes you in its grip. And that ultimately clouds your intellect, your judgment. You can't judge properly because your mind is then distorted. Your thoughts are then polluted. They are tainted. You cannot think clearly. There is no concentration. By whims and fancies they waver. You can't properly judge what is good, what is bad. And this therefore leads to all the problems. And this also gives birth to the hatred. If there is attachment to something, it leads to hatred to another thing. So this attachment and hatred, raga and dvesha, as they call it, attachment and hatred, the feeling of revenge, the feeling of causing pain to others, this is what leads to the conflict, the disharmony. And the main question therefore revolves to this: how can we have a harmonious personality? By getting rid of these two negative forces, which are actually the cause of the disharmony and the whole trouble. These are the villains of the story, as a matter of fact. You take any conflict, it may be at the international level, national level, or at the interpersonal level. It may be in political arena, it may be in the field of economics or whatever, it may be in the family or even in your own mind, you will find that these are the two forces, the negative forces, which always cause the disharmony. So the main question comes, how to be free from these, because every human being is being puppet to these. Everyone is dancing to their tune. Like they, if you come to India, you will see people showing the monkey dancing at the beat of a drum. Someone ties the monkey, a noose to the monkey, and then the monkey dances to that tune. That is what makes the noise. Our mind is dancing to these two evil factors. We are therefore all slaves. The slogan is our freedom, that every one of us wants freedom. Freedom of speech, freedom of thought. As the drama itself pointed, how beautiful thought is. A single thought may create a big city. So it's not that one wants passivity. Thought is very essential to our life. It's something beautiful. If it is properly developed, it's not that there should be stillness or there should be passivity. Thought has to be there. That is a sign of life. But what kind of thought has to be there which creates harmony, which creates better feelings, better relations, and not this kind of disharmony, which is the reason, which is the cause for peace and for peacelessness. And you will find that it is these two which are causing trouble to everyone. Just think over the past years of your life, each one of us. Let us peep for a while into our mind. Let us have a look on our past. How many people we made sad by these two passions, by our anger, by our hatred, by speaking roughly, by losing our temper, by being insultive to others, by not giving them the respect that we should have given them, by having been kind as they expected. You will find that these kinds of human accidents, accidents in life, in our relations, have in every case been numerous. How many people have been given peptic ulcers by their family members who would every now and then proclaim that they love them very much, but they would behave in such a manner, treat others in such a way, and their behavior would be such that it would be causing peptic ulcers to many. And when a patient goes to a doctor giving the story, saying that the person is suffering from peptic ulcer or a tumor because of some trauma or maybe the first stage of cancer, the doctor would give the patient some medicine, some treatment, or maybe that he would operate upon the patient, and the patient would think that he or she has been cured for a while. But what can the doctor do? The doctor is not treating the man in the home who is actually giving the peptic ulcer. The doctor has treated only the patient, but someone who gave the peptic ulcer is there in the family, in the home, who actually has not been exposed to the doctor. The doctor knows here there is something which must be operated upon. But there is a man over there, his mind also must be operated upon. He doesn't know. Actually, he is the cause of the whole trouble. And that is the stuff of which the mind is made of. It is softer than the molten wax. Let us take notice of this. Whenever we utter a single word, it, because of the sensitivity of the human mind, it is leaving its trace on the human mind. It is giving someone some good or bad feeling. It is causing either peacelessness or making another person happy. But let us judge ourselves rather than someone else judge ourselves, us. How many people we treat in a way so that we have added some comfort, some happiness to their life, given peace to some? Is it that we have given them trauma, some suffering, some sadness? Have we made this society better? Have we contributed toward the good of the human society? Or we have been the cause of the turmoil, we have made some contribution to the conflict? That is for us to think, because here is actually the cause of the that sound that was going on in the head. Too much of noise in our mind, and we switching on the noise in other people's mind. Someone may be not having noise, but maybe that we too make too much noise, so that the other is also influenced by that kind of noise. Previously, people thought that if one smokes, then it is his personal concern. How are others concerned with it? But now everyone knows that those who are passive smokers, those who do not smoke, and if they are sitting near a smoker, then the smoke from the smoker can cause the disease to the non-smokers. Because if some particles from their smoke settle on their lips or go into their breathing system via nose, then into the lungs, then they also may get cancer. So anyone who does the action, it influences the others, let's understand. So the way we look at others, the way we speak, the way we make gestures, the way even we think, because even at the vibrational level, our thought waves, the doctors now can, by application of electrodes to our head, see what kind of thought we are having, which is giving us relaxation or making us tense. And these brain waves not only make ourselves tense, but they cause some kind of disharmony at the vibrational level in the whole world. If therefore we do not feel the responsibility for our thoughts, for our speech and for our actions, how can the harmony be created? And this is where we must know the mind, because this noise is going on in the mind. We are influencing the mind of others. And this question of harmony or disharmony is associated with the way we think, because even what we speak is first of all in the form of the thought. It is the thought which is translated into speech or action. We must therefore take care of our thought, how we handle it. This thought can hit a person's mind as a bullet, or it can make another person comfortable. How many people in our lifetime we have made them to weep, to shed tears, to have some kind of a sorrow? We have hurt their feelings. We have read roughshod over them. We have trampled them over their sensibilities by our behavior. And this is what causes disharmony. And I said, what is there in our behavior or in our speech or in our thoughts which creates disharmony and gives this kind of feeling of trauma, of peacelessness, of sadness? It is these two, these passions and possessions, the emotional disturbance, our emotional immaturity. This is therefore what is required to be set right if we want that the world should be a better place to live in, that there should be harmony, there should be no wars, no fights, no quarrels. And even in our own mind, there shouldn't be any kind of typhoons or earthquakes. What is happening in our mind? Not only just noise, but I think there are raging in our mind some kind of earthquakes. Some volcanoes are erupting. What happens when a person is angry? There is so much lava which comes in the form of the speech from an angry man. So it's not that you require a geologist to tell you why there are certain parts of the globe which are earthquake prone. But our own mind is always earthquake prone, because there is the anger. It shakes not only us but also the others. It shakes the mountains. Because if you know the karma philosophy, it is the inner earthquakes which bring the outer earthquakes. Because they are the punishment. The nature punishes us. Why does the nature punish us? After all, what we have to reap is according to our karma, what we do, what we deserve. We may desire something else, But the question is, what do we deserve? And our whatever we deserve depends upon our actions, our speech, our thoughts, our behavior, our way of life, our lifestyle, our treatment of others. This is what it makes the whole life. What is the name of life? What is life? Sometimes we measure life in terms of years. This person is so many years old. But is it the real measure of life, the biological measure of life? Even biologically speaking, the measure of life in terms of days and weeks is perhaps not the proper measure. How many happy days in our life we have? That is the measure of life. That is what we have actually lived. If we have been having pain, it is worse than death. Because death causes pain. And in our lifetime, if we are having pain, sorrow, suffering, sadness, grief, dramas, because of anger, because of hatred, because of feeling of taking revenge, because of violence, the outburst in our mind, not mere noise, but outbursts, the volcanic eruptions going on in our mind. They say many civilizations got buried because of the volcanic eruptions. Many got buried down below the earth because of earthquakes. Many got buried because of some meteor having fallen on the earth and hit the earth hard so that they were destroyed. And what is happening in our mind? Whatever in India, in ancient lore, there is the saying, Yatha Pinde Tatha Brahmande. As inside, so outside. You will find that whatever happens outside is also happening inside. You will find an analogy in your own inside. We are thinking of space. Some people saying the space we find outside depends upon our outlook, our attitude. Because the main thing is the consciousness, our concepts of time, our concepts of space. All depend upon our ways of thinking, our attitudes, how we look at things. Our consciousness is the basic, which forms the ideas, the concepts, the theories, the hypothesis, which does all the research and then gives us some kind of understanding. So deep is our mind, so powerful it is, and so many dimensions it has, so many abilities it has, which are yet unexplored. And many have atrophied. They have died down because of not being used, because we don't know how much is there in the mind. It's such a hidden treasure which we have not made of. Why? It is because the anger and the hatred have killed our mind. It has vitiated our mind, spoiled our mind. And many of our abilities have been burned down by these kind of eruptions, these kinds of volcanoes. The earthquakes within us have destroyed so much of valuable treasure within us. Leave aside the disharmony outside, because of the disharmony in our own mind, how much we suffer. When a person is angry, if you just measure his muscular tone, his blood lactate, his heartbeat, his breathing rate, and so on, you would find there is an earthquake. Every cell of his body is affected. We are killing ourselves before killing anybody else. You tell me if any man can make another person happy, unhappy, before himself becoming unhappy. If you want to make another person unhappy, you have first of all to be unhappy. You can't make another person feel sad unless and until you yourself are sad. So do we understand that by creating disharmony in our own mind and out into the world, what difficulties we are creating for the whole world? And the quality we are giving to this world. We are making it inhabitable for us and also for others. And therefore I said that we have first of all to learn to control our passions and to understand what leads to the ultimate result if we have always this basic urge of possessing. And by dispossessing others, by being so competitive, just trying to be so unjust and so unfair, by giving up our integrity and honesty. That is actually what causes disharmony. The fight mainly is between the haves and have-nots. And if you just disturb the balance, whether it may be in politics, in economics, or wherever, there are certain balances. Life is based on some balances. If you just disturb those balances, you will find that there is disharmony. Harmony is the name of some balances. And disharmony is due to that disturbance in the balance. One Urdu poet has said, Zindagi kya hai? Zindagi kya hai? Anasir ka nazam o tartib. Zindagi kya hai? Anasir ka nazam o tartib. Maut kya hai? Inka pareshan hona. Maut kya hai? Inka pareshan hona. He says, what is life? What is this symphony of life? It's because of some balances. One system fitting into another. And this gives the life. And if this system is disturbed, if there is some kind of a disharmony, even between our various body organs and between our various systems, then it leads to death. Of the happiness, we will be deprived of it. And therefore is the reason why we just try to understand what our mind is, what our self is, what other people's mind is. And I think because of not understanding this, our treatment is not proper, our behavior is not as it should be, and our relationship with others at times, or perhaps oft times, is inhuman rather than human. If we just try to understand the nature of the mind, there can be nothing more sensitive. Even the matter at the subatomic level, where they say the presence of the observer disturbs the experiments. The very presence of the observer. Because it is at such a subtle level that if you just try to perform experiments with the subatomic particles, or even if you want to observe what is happening over there, your very presence disturbs the experiment. But I would say mind is more sensitive than that. All the time it is taking influences from the outside. Something is going on. So let us therefore be aware of what stuff the mind is made of. There are sensibilities, sensitivities, there are emotions, and there are some expectations, there are some desires. And unless or until you understand that it is this which is mind, and as I desire, so do others desire. As I expect, so do others expect. As I am influenced, so are others influenced. As I feel good or bad when people react in a particular way, so do other people also feel. Then how can I treat others as I wish to be treated by? Let us first of all understand, so sensitive is human being. Someone researched to find out which is the most bitter thing in the world. He researched and researched. Which is the most bitter thing in the world? After doing research for so many years, having been out of his home, moving from place to place, questioning people, going to places, trying to taste many things, reading books and books in libraries, he came ultimately to his house. He pressed the button of the bell. His wife came to open the door, and she began to shout. She said, now you come back, why you come back, you know. So bitterly she spoke. Then he thought, I was trying to research the bitterness, but there cannot be anything more bitter than the speech of a human being. Because she spoke in such a way, then he said, now perhaps my research is complete. It's over. So who is it that tastes? Not our tongue, the bitterness. The bitterness is in our words. So is the sweetness in our words. So is the sourness in our words. Let us beware. And that is why therefore we should be nice to others. How should we treat others? So I was saying that there are some expectations. Everyone wants respect. You also want respect. So if you don't give respect to others, how can there be harmony? You are provoking the person. You are antagonizing the person. Then there will be hatred, there will be anger. Because everyone wants to possess. Possess not only in the material sense. To have. Possess means to have. To have the respect. There are certain things which you want to have, not merely money, not merely a building, not merely a car. But there are many things which are basic to life. If we want to live, we want to live as a respectful person, in a dignified way. Not a cat and dog life, but as a human being. And that is what a human being wants as a right, as a basic right. That is what he has been striving for. So you must give respect if you want to create harmony. You want people should love you. Similarly, you must give love. If you don't give love, if there is no give and take of love, there can be no harmony. There will be conflict. Why? There will be again noise in the head, and then again there will be headache. Why there is the headache? Headache is not, the doctor does not know why the headache is there. He asks the patient, show me the tongue. The patient shows the tongue. Okay, your tongue is bad. He gives the medicine. But there is something else which is going on in the head. The scientist used to apply some, I don't know what it applied. But the patient was feeling hot, and how he cried, you know, in the end you all know. So what happens is that we have to see what is happening in our mind, and we have to take care of that. And if you therefore don't love, love is actually perhaps the force, the energy, which has not been researched. People have done a lot of research on electricity, magnetism, heat, and so on. Spent so much of time, money and energy, billions of dollars and rubles they have spent on the research on various forms of energy. But what kind of thing love is? Love. Love. How wonderful love is. Love is the most, potent, effective force which unites people, which creates the unity of minds, the harmony which we are actually trying to establish. It is love which can change the world. Archimedes said, give me a rod long enough and strong enough and I will move the whole world. In the Principle on Livers, he made this statement. And I think love is the rod which, when given, it is strong enough and long enough. It is this which can move the whole world. But the value, the importance, the significance, the effectiveness of love is not yet properly researched, not properly yet known. So as I want love, I have to give love to others. As I want respect, I expect respect. I need respect because I want to lead my life as a dignified individual. I have to give respect. Similarly, there are other things which are the expectations of human minds. This is the nature of human mind. So many psychologists, psychiatrists, and social scientists who deal with the human nature, they understand that these are the basic needs of the human mind. Just as there are some basic needs for the human body, similarly there are some basic needs for the human mind. If there is no love, there is no cooperation, there is no adjustment, there is no kindness, there is no sympathy, there are certain values which are very important for creating a spirit of harmony. If we do not cooperate, then people feel bad about it. Then there is disharmony. So cooperation is a value which will create harmony. Similarly, adjustment. One man has one views, another man has other views. So if you just begin to fight on the basis of this, there can be no end to this. There has to be some kind of reconciliation, some kind of accommodation, some kind of respect still being given to each one's way of thinking. There has to be some kind of adjustment. So there are some values which, when followed in our life, will create harmony. Whereas if these are not followed, then you find there will be disharmony. But all these factors which lead to disharmony are hinged mainly upon, as I said earlier, passion and dispassion. Because they say, कामात क्रोध उपजायते, क्रोधात भवति सम्मोह. इट इज फ्रॉम यूर काम, फ्रॉम यूर वेरी एम्बिशियसनेस, फ्रॉम यूर एंडलेस डिजायर्स, दैट इज बॉर्न द एंगर, बिकॉज सम ऑफ देम वुड नॉट ऑलवेज बी फुलफिल्ड. एंड इफ यूर डिजायर्स आर नॉट फुलफिल्ड, यू आर लायबल टू बी एंग्री, एंड फ्रॉम एंगर इज बॉर्न डिल्यूजन, यूर माइंड विल बी क्लाउडेड, अगेन यू विल नॉट बी एबल टू मेक जजमेंट, एंड दैट विल लीड यू टू डिसहार्मनी एंड अल्टीमेटली टू वार्स एंड टू डिस्ट्रक्शन. सो देयर फॉर यू हैव, इफ यू वॉन्ट्स हार्मनी, यू हैव नॉट ओनली टू केयर फॉर यूर ओन फुलफिलमेंट ऑफ यूर डिजायर्स, बट द डिजायर्स ऑफ अदर्स. दैट इज वॉट एकोमोडेशन इज, दैट इज वॉट एडजस्टमेंट इज. यू हैव नॉट टू बी ओवर एम्बिशियस, लेट देर विल बी अदर, लेस देर विल बी सम काइंड ऑफ टर्माइल इन यूर ओन माइंड. एंड एज आई वॉज सेइंग अबाउट पोजेसिवनेस, द मोर यू हैव द मोर यू वॉन्ट टू हैव. आई हैव येट टू सी ए मैन हु हैज सो मच, दैट सो मच इन टर्म्स ऑफ वेल्थ, सो मच ऑफ रेस्पेक्ट, सो हाई ए स्टेटस इन द सोसाइटी. एवरी थिंग दिस पर्सन हैज हैड. Others would say he is very lucky, very fortunate. There is nothing which he lacks in his life. But still this want, man is wanting more, more and more, more and more. There is no end to it, because there is spirit of jealousy, of rivalry, of competition. One wants to have more and more. So there is no end to this. But there has to be some kind of a self-control which is necessary for harmony. If we want the society to be harmony, there has to be justice, there has to be equality, there has to be proper distributive system, there has to be economic justice. This kind of thing can only create harmony, and this is possible only when we have self-controls, so that our desires do not go wild. We are not puppets into the hands of our desires. And a Sanskrit scholar has said, भोगा न भुक्ता वयमेव भुक्ता, कालो न याति वयमेव याता. He says it is not that we consume the goods when we eat, when we use them, but the things also consume us in the process. When you eat, your stomach also by eating those things is used, and in use there is always wear and tear. When you eat, you chew things with your gums and your teeth, then there is wear and tear of your teeth, and so on and so forth. There, all the things which you consume, you think you are consuming, but you should understand they are also consuming you in a way. So beware, think over it. You should take as much as is necessary for life. If you over consume, if you think I eat too much of almonds or coconuts or ice cream, or take many tonics, and you will become like Ali the boxer. It's not possible, because you will get stomach trouble. You have to take only as much as your body can accept. If you overeat, what will happen? All of us know the consequences. Therefore, has been said that gluttony is one of the vices. We have not to be slaves to our tongue. We have to control our tongue in many ways. This 2.5 inches tongue, maybe 3 inches in some cases, has to be controlled. If it is not properly controlled, it can be the cause of a trouble. Sometimes it comes out when it shouldn't come out. It moves when it shouldn't move. It needs to be shut up, but perhaps no locks as yet have been made for it, which are very essential. So these are the things which we have to keep in mind. If we want to create harmony, there must be a harmonious personality which has these abilities. And how can we create harmonious personality? It is through meditation. There is a disharmony. Disharmony is in the mind. The disharmony outside also is hinged on the disharmony in our mind. And the disharmony in our mind is the disharmony between the mind and intellect, between the mind and conscience, between the intellect and the emotions. The disharmony is because of the infight. Our own house is divided. Our own mind speaks in so many voices, like in a stock market, in a fish market maybe. There it is going on like this in our mind. Therefore is there so much noise and headache. And for that, As I said, I gave earlier the example of the bee sitting on the beehive. Taste the honey. Taste the honey. As I said, the life is not to be measured in terms of years, but in two ways. One is how much happiness you have given to others. These are the memorable events of your life. How many you wiped the tears of others? How many sad people you gave them the comforts? How many were the people who felt forlorn, who felt they are deprived, who felt that they are peaceless, and you gave them peace? It is in these memorable events that the life has to be made. This is one way. The second is, how many good actions, how many these kinds of events, these kinds of experiences you had in your life? Because that would give you the satisfaction. If our long part of our life has passed in trauma, in sadness, in suffering, in disease, the life really was not worth living. What is the fun of measuring the life in terms of years, a life which has been full of suffering, full of ill health, full of trauma? So therefore, if we want to make our life full of joy, full of happiness, and I would say, over and above all this, and better than this, and what is most important is bliss. Bliss, which comes of purity, which comes of our being in tune with the Supreme, who is the ocean of bliss. This is what meditation is for, which creates the harmony between our mind and body, which creates the harmony between one person and another, which creates the harmony in the whole society. Because human being is the unit of the society. If a human being is transformed, the transformation of the society has started. And you already know the story of the 100th monkey. You know, a monkey was eating a carrot, sitting on a branch of a tree, and he did not relish it. The carrot fell down. The tree was on the bank of a river. There was slope, and the carrot rolled down to the bank of the river, and as it was stirred by the water and the mud was dissolved, then the monkey took it again and found it was very tasty. So he learnt that in future, before eating the carrot, he should wash it. And without any TV, without any radio, without any newspapers, which always print the bad news, because they think bad news are good news for them. So you would always find who has been killed, who has been raped, what happened where. All, when you get up in the morning, I think when a person has read the newspaper, if a doctor examines him after this, he will find at least his temperature is up by something, you know. And his blood pressure is a little bit up. Therefore, he wants to have a cup of tea in order to neutralize perhaps the whole thing. Then again, there is so much of niacin in man's head and perhaps a little bit of, no, but that we have accustomed to. So what I was saying was that if we just consider our life in these terms and try to have that kind of meditation which can give us that bliss which is born of purity and which is born of our absorption into the Supreme Being, that is the real understanding of our mind and the mind of others. And that is what will create harmony. And this is what this university is teaching. How to meditate, how to calm down our mind. It's not through the electrical gadgets that you will calm it down, because the electrical gadgets also have been made by the sound of our noise of our mind. But this kind of noise will be stilled by some other process. And not only that, meditation will give us peace, it will not give us passivity. On the other hand, it will stir up our intuition. We will have better faculty of understanding. We will have better creativity. We will have more efficiency. And we will have more concentration. We will be more active. We will be more youthful. We will have more energy. Because we will be free from worry, from anxiety, and from fear, from suspicion, from all the negativity which is eating into our vital forces. Having all these been preserved and conserved, and our mind having been freed from all these negativities, we will find more and more powerful spiritually. Our will be strong, our thoughts will be powerful. And what is most important is that not only disharmony would have left us, which is now presently deeply entrenched in our mind, would have wound up its tents and gone, but on the other hand, you will find a kind of a stability, kind of a balance. And as a matter of fact, this harmony will come through certain balances. You must have some balances. The balance, as I was saying, the balance is life. The disturbance in equilibrium and in balances, that is the imbalances which are caused, are the cause of disharmony. So there should be balance between love and law. There should be balance between humility and self-respect. Because sometimes we put so much emphasis on self-respect, there may be another person who has some susceptibilities, some sensitivities have been hurt, and therefore at that time we have to be humble, to have patience, to have sobriety. So there has to be balance of humility and the self-respect. Also, there has to be balance of rigidity and flexibility. Sometimes we are so rigid, we don't accommodate others. Sometimes we are so flexible, people say he is a whimsical person, a wavering person. He never sticks to his plan. He says one thing, does another thing. So that also is bad. That is not an integrated personality or a harmonious personality. So if we have all these kinds of balances, that is what will create harmony. And always remember, still there is scope for some negative forces intruding into your mind, invading your mind. Then take one tactic, there is a trick. Always there is a trick of the trade. There is a way of doing things. They say there is way even in madness, method even in madness. So even when madness comes to our mind, let us be methodical at least. What is the method? Just remember these two words. One is, when a bad thought comes to your mind, you want to be angry. Someone has provoked you, insulted you, been very unfair to you. You feel very uncomfortable. You want to shout, to tell this man, to pay him in the same kind. You think this man has been very rough. Let me teach him a lesson for life. So this thought comes in your mind. And what you should do? Since it has come anyway, you open the door and it has come. What to do? Postpone this. You know how to postpone. You postpone many things, I know. So that ability is there in all of us, which is perhaps a disability, but you can convert it into ability. Postpone this. When you think of being angry, think not today, tomorrow. You see? Tomorrow I teach this man a lesson. And tomorrow you think, let me postpone for another day, and by that time your anger would have left you. So then when they say forgive others, forget and forgive, this is the way you can forget and forgive. So when a bad thought comes in your mind, a negative urge is there, and when you want to rough up a person because he has mauled you, hold on, think, calm down, and think that not today, tomorrow. Okay? This is one thing. And the other is, whenever a good thought comes to your mind, always there is scope for good thought. That also you have. It's not a kind of ability which is not present in every one of us. It is there. We take notice of what is good in all others. At times when we are feeling very jubilant, jovial, when we are in a good mood after taking a hot cup of coffee or tea, when we enjoy life, we see good point in everyone. Always look at good things. If there is a dark aspect of the man, there is also a positive aspect of him. Just look at the positive aspect. But besides that, what else should do? Any idea which is good idea, you want to be kind, you want to be compassionate, you want to be sympathetic, you want to be generous, you want to offer love, whatever good thoughts come to your mind, never postpone them. This is how you can change. Do it immediately. But then you postpone, I tell you. Because when a thought comes, I give this man a gift, you know, a good thought has come to your mind. But you say, not today, today I have other work to do, tomorrow perhaps I do it. Give him this gift today. So whenever there is a good thought in your mind, do it immediately. And whenever there is a bad thought, postpone it once more. And if you can postpone it for the third time, all the good. And this is how we get transformed. We change. We will be able to have emotional control, emotional stability. And that is what I was talking about. And this will avoid disharmony, prevent disharmony. This is a preventive measure which you are taking. And by taking this preventive measure, you will become immune to all these attacks in course of time. All these negative thoughts will give up your mind. Your mind will no longer be a battlefield. Enjoy life, be happy, be blissful. Don't worry, be happy is the song. So don't worry, always be happy. And when you practice meditation, your mind will be so peaceful, so blissful, you cannot become angry. After practicing meditation, if I try to provoke you, you just try, do an experiment. You practice meditation, I try to provoke you. You cannot become peaceless. Because you are peaceful. You are so peaceful, so peaceful, so blissful, so loveful. You don't accept that rubbish anymore. Your mind is full. There is no more space for all these negative thoughts. You don't care for all these things. You are above it. Now these things cannot influence you, cannot touch you. Such is the art and science or the way of meditation. Thank you so much. Om Shanti. If there are any questions.
It would be nice to have the lights up in the auditorium.
Firstly, I'd just like to say thank you very much. And I've never spoken in front of everybody before. But what's the similarity between the animals in the world and humans? Like you were just saying about the bee. I can feel like a bee sometimes. And I can feel like a bull. Different types of animals. Is there a similarity? Sit down until...
No, it's not clear to me.
Okay, sorry. There's all different types of insects.
Mm-hmm, yes.
Okay, and...
You are asking about insects?
The similarity between, in your mind, how, you, say, when I'm angry, I can feel like an animal. Okay, and you're saying, leave it till tomorrow. I can feel light. If I'm walking across ice, the ice is going to break, so I have to walk gently. So in my mind, I take myself up high, and I can walk across the ice. If I walk across the ice like a rhino, I'm going to go through. If I'm breaking a wall down, I have to break the wall like a rhino. Am I confusing you?
Yeah. No, actually, kya keh rahe? What does? Could somebody explain to me what he said clearly? Perhaps.
Yes, if I understand it correctly. Are you talking about similarities between human beings and animals, where we adopt certain characteristics that are similar to different animals? For instance, you shouldn't be like a bull in a china shop, for instance.
Yeah. Well, the control of, like, one minute you can be peaceful and calm, and somebody will do something to you, and If I run, I'm like a leopard. I'm not running like a rhino. If I hadn't seen any animal in my life, as if I was just born in a jungle. Now, sorry, I'm conscious. If I hadn't seen an animal in my life and I'd been born in a concrete building, would I have these feelings of being
having anger or hatred or something?
When you have pain, when you have anger, and you want to run. When you run, how do you run? How do you lift yourself? You have to put your mind into and you run like the wind. So you have to.
It is even now not clear to me, but you perhaps want to know that if we had been brought up in some house made of concrete and we were not having any observation of the animals, which are angry, which have hated, which have these kinds of things, then perhaps we would be different.
Yeah, that's
what you mean?
Yeah.
No, actually what happens is, on the other hand, you will see, it can be explained, that animals have learnt it from us. Not that we have learnt it from animals.
Animals have learnt it from us?
From human beings.
Right. Are humans here to maintain the land?
Because when human beings become angry, and angry also with the animals actually do not have this kind of tendency. It is only later in their history that they acquired it. Of course, Darwin and those who believe in evolution theory would put it differently. They would say these are the animalistic behavior. And since we descended from the ape, therefore we have a bit of animal inside. But we, on the other hand, would say that we have degenerated over a period of time. And because of our degeneration, the animals also have been influenced. And if they have now anger and hatred and all these kinds of negative things, they have imitated and copied from ourselves. It's not that we copied the monkey, but the monkey copied it from us. That's what we say. But it would require elaborate explanation. This is just a statement I made. If I have to make it valid, justify it, then a lot of explanation has to be given. But this is our stand is. Yeah, there are similar characteristics because there are same instincts. Those instinctive effect is there. But human beings have more developed intellect and the more sense of morality and also a stronger will. So because of that, they can be transformed, changed. Whereas animals also can be changed, but to a lesser degree. Animals can be changed by human behavior. If a human being is good, the animals which have some kind of enmity from the very time of their birth, even they would be coexisting by the influence of this human being. As has been found that if some sages had become very peaceful, then in their hermitage, even the lions would be there without killing any